Innovation needs not only visionaries, but also storytellers. Steve Jobs was a great storyteller. So is Elon Musk. But when does storytelling go too far? How much of today's AI mania is driven by facts and how much by fiction? What should you be doing with your money right now? Human beings are optimists by nature. Cognitive scientists have shown that most people consistently overestimate their likelihood of positive events. However, without our optimism bias, there will be little innovation or entrepreneurship. There will be little progress. I don't think I'm exaggerating when I say that AI is playing to our optimism bias like no other innovation before. It is why S&P 500 is up 14% year to date, while expected earnings per share for the year is down 12%. It is why a promise by OpenAI, a company with a forecasted revenue of just $13 billion this year, to pay Oracle $300 billion over the next 5 years, drove up Oracle's stock price by 40% earlier this month and briefly made Larry Ellison the richest man on the planet. Our optimism bias fuels innovation, but also bubbles. Is AI already in a bubble? Whether AI is a bubble or not, it has many similarities to the dot-com bubble. For example, the current price-to-earnings ratio of S&P 500 is at its highest level since the dot-com bubble. If overinvestment is a sign of bubble, spending on information processing equipment and software reached 4.46% in the second quarter, the peak reached at the height of the dot-com bubble. As I pointed out in a previous video, the capex to sales ratio of the biggest American companies is already at their all-time high. But these are not conclusive evidence of a bubble. To determine whether the elevated market valuation of AI makes it a bubble or not, we need to answer two questions. One, is the current growth rate of AI chip sales sustainable? Two, is AI a winner-takes-all technology? The importance of the first question is obvious, but the second question, which is often overlooked in the debate, is even more important. At the end of the day, what matters for the stock market is not how innovative a company is, but how much money it actually makes. As Microsoft, the second most valuable company in the world, proves, monopoly status is more important than innovation. Will AI lend itself to monopolies? I'm skeptical. Even though ChatGPT remains the most popular large language model with the highest number of subscribers, the competition is intense. In the latest performance ranking by Chatbox Arena Plus, ChatGPT 5.0 is behind both Gemini 2.5 Pro and Grok 4.0 and just ahead of the three Chinese models. Knowledge distillation, a technique that enables AI rivals to clone each other's capabilities, makes it difficult for any model to stay ahead for very long. Indeed, a model that takes years of R&D to build can now be replicated in months and at a fraction of the cost. I said in a video earlier this year that DeepSeek is not proof of China's technological prowess, but proof that AI can be easily copied. Whether this will always be the case or not, so far this reality has not changed. This is why I find it difficult to justify the current $500 billion valuation of OpenAI in the private market. OpenAI says it plans to become profitable by 2029. Unless we see a major change in the model architecture and/or the legal framework, it seems to me like a very ambitious goal. This brings me to AI chips. Currently, NVIDIA controls 80% of the AI chips market, but this is clearly not sustainable. AMD, offering a more cost-effective alternative to NVIDIA's offering, has been gaining market share, which reportedly has finally reached 15%. AWS has begun to deploy its own training and chips at scale into its data centers. Earlier this month, Google, in a bid to challenge NVIDIA's dominance, started placing its own TPU chips in data centers operated by smaller cloud providers. There's, of course, also China to consider. Cambricon Technologies, a Chinese AI chip designer, just reported a 44 times increase in revenue. But Cambricon is just one of many Chinese companies working on their own AI chips. This week, Huawei unveiled a plan to overtake NVIDIA in 3 years. It also predicts that its Atlas 950 super pod can deliver 6.7 times more computing power than NVIDIA's NVL144 system to be launched in the second half of next year. I cannot help but see China's decision last week to ban all purchases of NVIDIA's chips as an acknowledgement by Beijing that Chinese chip players are quickly catching up to NVIDIA. What about chip manufacturing? TSMC is the dominant global manufacturer of advanced AI logic chips, making most of NVIDIA's AI chips. But if it were up to Donald Trump, this won't last for much longer. Trump's decision to take a 10% stake in Intel last month should be viewed as the first step towards reviving U.S. chip manufacturing production. NVIDIA's $5 billion investment in Intel earlier this month could be the second step. Jensen Huang said that Trump had nothing to do with the Intel deal. But who was he trying to fool? It wouldn't surprise me at all if Trump soon starts pressuring NVIDIA to work with Intel on making its next generation AI chips. Surely, it won't be bullish for America's AI companies if they all end up having to subsidize Trump's industrial policies in one way or another. I'm an economist and not a technologist. What I see in my crystal ball is a fragmented market for AI across the entire supply chain, especially once China has caught up with the US. As I said in a previous video, the AI battle will likely determine the outcome of the current power struggle between the US-dominated unipolar world order and the multipolar world order challengers. The elevated valuation of US tech stocks suggests the market is pricing a US win. But facts on the table suggest this outcome is not a given. This is an important reason why I think AI is already in a bubble. What could burst a bubble? As I will explain next, the greatest risk to the market is if the US is overinvesting in a technology that is not ready for prime time. Hyperscalers are building out AI centers like there is no tomorrow. As noted by Neil Dutta at Renaissance Macro Research, AI-related CapEx contributed more to GDP growth in the US than consumer spending in the first half of this year. This is reminiscent of the boom in the build-out of long-haul fiber optic lines in the mid-1990s. Just like then, the mantra right now is build now and monetize later. The key lesson from the fiber bust is that it might take a long time for demand to catch up with supply. This was the main reason behind the bankruptcy of WorldCom and many US carriers in 2001 and 2002. Microsoft and Google may have deeper pockets than WorldCom and Global Crossing. But expensive AI chips depreciate much more quickly than fiber optic assets. Whereas fiber optic cables are depreciated over 20 to 25 years, there's a very short window between every upgrade cycle in AI chips. This means the hyperscalers cannot afford to wait too long for demand to come on. By one estimate, Meta, Amazon, Microsoft, Google, and Tesla will by the end of this year have collectively poured $560 billion on AI-related CapEx spending since the beginning of 2024, against an AI-related revenue of only $35 billion. There's no denying that investors don't seem to care. All that matters to the market right now is how many more chips these guys are buying. But is the market right to assume that these companies have a better read on the future of AI demand? I don't know. But what I do know is this. Demand growth has to accelerate much more than it has for them to justify keeping up their CapEx spending. This is the million-dollar question. Where will demand growth be coming from over the next 6 to 12 months? OpenAI says that ChatGPT has already 800 million active weekly users and 10 million paid subscribers on its premium ChatGPT platform. Google Search, the most popular website in the world, has 5 billion users. If we were to assume ChatGPT reaches 50% of that, which is an extremely generous assumption. This will translate into 20 million more paid subscribers for ChatGPT. But at just $20 a month, this will bring just $5 billion more in revenue a year. What about the corporate side of the business? OpenAI claims to have over 3 million paying enterprise business users. That already compares well with the 2 million companies that Microsoft says are using Microsoft 365. A recent Gallup poll suggests that 40% of American workers say that they're already using AI in their roles. A recent report on the state of AI by the MIT Media Lab finds that despite $30 and $40 billion of enterprise general AI spending, 95% of organizations reported no measurable P&L impact from their pilots. Only 5% reached production with meaningful value. This verdict does not bode well for the consensus of rapid acceleration in corporate adoption. My bet is that the fact that ChatGPT 5.0 is only incrementally better than 4.0 will give chief technology officers even more excuses to take a wait-and-see attitude. The MIT report flagged the rise of shadow AI, with workers using their own ChatGPT accounts to write emails, summarize documents, and brainstorm solutions. Ironically, this growing trend could reduce further the incentive of companies to embark on major and expensive enterprise-level AI initiatives. My back-of-the-envelope analysis says that AI CapEx spending will have to slow. The growing political backlash from the pressure that data centers is placing on the national energy grid is another headwind for the AI CapEx drive. America's largest power grid is under strain as data centers and AI chatbots consume power faster than new plants can be built. This week, the governors of more than a quarter of U.S. states pushed for greater influence over PJM interconnection, the country's largest power grid. With rapidly rising electricity prices in the U.S. cities via capacity charges and grid upgrades, we should expect a direct confrontation between states and the hyperscalers in 2026 that will result in a slowdown in AI-related CapEx spending further. In my view, with rapidly rising electricity prices in the U.S. cities via capacity charges and grid upgrades, we will see a direct confrontation between states and the hyperscalers in 2026 that will result in a further slowdown in AI-related CapEx spending. I like AI. AI has helped raise my productivity as an analyst. It helps me gather information and even helps improve my writing. However, I think AI stocks are a bubble right now. The bubble will burst, and the only uncertainty is when. When it does, we will see a slowdown of the U.S. economy, more aggressive Fed interest rate cuts, and a lower U.S. dollar. I think it is too early to buy bonds and sell the dollar right now. But I continue to like my short on NASDAQ, even with the money I've already lost over the past month. Nobody says betting against bubbles is easy, especially when you're up against some of the best storytellers that Silicon Valley has ever produced. But I'm not giving up yet. Thank you for listening.